topics are politics and music. Now, there are those who say that politics and art just don't mix. But before we get into all of this, I just want to say a word about Sonny Bono. I mean, the guy bothers me. Ever since he was elected mayor of Palm Springs, it seems like singing politicians are cropping up everywhere. I do have to say, however, I was happy to learn that the singer Alice Cooper has been running for office somewhere out west, and he's got a really great slogan. His slogan is, "A troubled man for troubled times." Now he's got my vote on that slogan along. But of course, now that so many singers are doing politics, a lot of politicians are starting to sing. So it's sort of evening the whole thing out. And lately, one with all the elections and amendment proposals, it's been a really great time to study the political art song format. I mean, just how do people convince each other of things that are sometimes basically quite preposterous? It's an art form. Listen carefully, and you'll discover these are not speeches at all, but actually quite sophisticated musical compositions. Now, take a guy like Hitler. You listen to his speeches, and they're all rhythm, no pitch. I mean, Hitler was a drummer, and a really good drummer. And he'd always start things off with a really simple kick snare idea, you know, boom, chick, boom, chick. And he'd lay down this really solid groove, and people would start getting into it, kind of moving to it. And then he'd add a few little variations, boom, 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 chick, boom, chick. And then he'd take a really wild solo, and people would be yelling and dancing, yeah. Now, don't forget, these were the people who invented the Christmas tree. So, in their mind, see, there's this fir tree out in the forest, and they say, yeah, this tree must be inside the house, inside, inside. They've got this thing about nature. It's the same with music. They've got to do something with it. They've got to bring it on home. So they're stomping and moving and grooving, and their feet are all sucked up to these drums, and they're moving like one giant thing. And pretty soon, they've got to go somewhere. They gotta get out. They gotta go somewhere. Like Poland. Or take Mussolini. You listen to his speeches and he's singing grand opera. He's doing all the arias, hitting all those hard to reach high notes. You know, Frontieri. He was always singing about the frontier. And all those fans up there in the third mezzanine with their hand sandwiches are going nuts. Yeah, they go wild. Opera fans. But of course, the all-time American master of this art form was Ronald Reagan. And when Reagan wanted to make a point, he would lean right into the mic. And he'd start talking softer and softer until he was talking.
Whoa.
That's right. Things are pretty different now. Now that people finally realize it's okay to have it all. Sure, there are a few stragglers. There's some yelling going on. Things like, "You jerk!" or, "Get out of my fucking neighborhood!" Hey, it's a free country. And in conclusion, I'd like to sing a short song. It's one of my favorites. And it goes something like this. Girls.
Smoke. Say, isn't that a flag? burning. I mean, that's the whole song. It's a big improvement over most national anthems, which are in 4-4, tying it, we're number one, this is the best place. I also like the B-side of the national anthem, Yankee Doodle. Truly a surrealist masterpiece. Yankee came to town, riding on a pony, stuck a feather in his hands, and called it macaroni. Now, if you can understand the words to this song, you can understand anything that's happening in the avant-garde today.
Oh.
Edwards was going to go down to the farm. kittens and the rabbits were out for a drive. Then little Barbara was crying, "Oh no!" And I remember looking around at the other kids to see if they were following any of this. And strange they was. They seemed to be. You know, there's a really strange animal out of the Bronx Zoo in New York City right now. In the exhibition called The World of Darkness. And it has the head of a mouse and the body of a miniature deer with tiny deer hooves. And it's an actual animal, not something manufactured. Says deer / mouse. It's like those ads you see in the paper for waitress / actress seeks employ. Yeah, well, see, it's this way. I'm a mouse, but I just work as a mouse. Days. It's a job. But what I really am is a deer. Or that's what I'd like to be someday. I mean, that's my aspiration. Knock on wood. Girls. Sailor suits. Oh, short shorts. sailors got off their boats, the Swedes, the Russians, the French, the Finns, the first thing they heard was, welcome. Welcome to the land of the free. Have a cupcake, girls.
Now, if my calculations are correct, taking population and inflation into account, by the year 2020, each citizen in New York City would have to be pulling in an annual gross income of $32 million in order to contribute his or her fair share.
Thank you. said, I know who you're trying to call, darling. And he's not home. He's been away. But you can hear him on the airwaves. He's a wound and a wound. Yeah, this is your country station. And honey, this next one. Sky, you.
science and religion have in common. So Chesty looked at Mapplethorpe's photographs, and they were pictures of men with no clothes and chains, black leathering crosses. A depiction that bothered the senator the most was a very large black dick sticking out of a business suit. So he made a law, and he said, we're not going to look at this, and you're not going to look at it either. You know, I remember as a kid sitting in church, and a preacher would point to pictures of Jesus Christ, who was wearing no clothes and bleeding profusely. And the preacher was saying, love this man. Love his body. He loves you. And all the men and boys were squirming around. They couldn't walk. They couldn't wait to get out of there. And this, of course, was the reason for the invention of Sunday afternoon football.
Crossed out. Someone else had written below. You mean
comes down the zigzag. That's the zigzag bar and grill. And everybody was talking at once. And it was getting real. I've been around the block, but I don't care. I'm on a whirl, I'm on a wild ride. 'Cause the moon is full. And look out, baby. I'm at high tide. I'm coming.
Shit!
there's this big whale swimming around and around in his tank. And the whale kept asking him questions, telepathically. And one of the questions the whale kept asking, way in the back of your closet, and you go into the closet and turn the knob and open it, and outside there it is, the immense Caribbean. And you can't believe it.
And they stayed up in the living room, and they cried.
So I get into this cab, and I tell the driver where I'm going. And he says, I'm not going that way. Incoming enemy missiles. Or idea, anyway. Recently, though, some of the military research has concentrated on the study of nature rather than technology. When the Army was trying to build a six-legged robot that could walk on the moon, they were having a lot of design problems. So they decided,
they've got six legs. Let's see how they do it.
So they spent an enormous amount of money on this research. And what they discovered was that six-legged insects can barely walk. They're constantly tipping over and tripping over their legs and breaking them off. But like all military research, it goes millions over budget. They keep reminding you.
Yeah, sure. We went a few million over, but think of the spin-off technologies. Tinfoil. The spray-on foods. Like spray-on cheese. You'd never discover this stuff without spending some extra cash.
But one of the most ambitious spin-offs is a company in Florida that's been advertising near the obituary columns. For a rather large fee, you can rent space in a capsule. And they take your ashes and they launch them into low orbit. Yeah, you could spin around forever out there with the rest of those spare parts. That is, until the day some astronaut drives by and your capsule smashes right into his windshield like a bug on a hot summer.